And brazen rabbit meat in Ghana, the demand for rabbit increases and so does the revenue. Let's have a conversation on the back of this. My name is Enyo and I'm joining the conversation on our social media platform on Facebook, LinkedIn, Instagram and on YouTube, The Ghanaian Farmer. Share your questions and your views with us. This program is proudly brought to you by Lizzy Tomato Mix. It gives your meal a great taste and gives a delicious taste as well. It consists a lot of vitamins as the festive season draws closer. Remember to buy Lizzy Tomato Mix when you are in the market shopping for the family. I'm going for a quick breather. When I come back, we'll have a conversation about rabbit farming here in Ghana. Stay tuned. Thanks for joining us. You're still watching The Ghanaian Farmer on Joy Prime. My name is Enyanam, and today's discussion is tailored towards rabbit farming here in Ghana. I'm joined by the farmer himself, Andy Bleusi. There's a third name. I'll hide that one for the meantime. And the farm is called The Unique Farms. What he does is rabbit rearing, and he's been doing it for quite a long time. But the interesting part is he has a degree in oil and gas processing. So we want to find out why he put his degree aside and ventured into rabbit farming. Thanks for joining us, Andy. And to begin with, why rabbit farming?
Okay, rabbit farming started for me way back when I was a kid. You know, at age 13, I got my first rabbit as a gift for myself because I saw the picture somewhere and then I just fell in love with them. So I got my first rabbit since then. And then I've been keeping them till now. So that's how it started for me. And that's why I'm still in it.
Right. Yeah. So how many years has it been so far?
Okay, probably I'll say it's been like 3 years of try and error thing. But then from age, let's say 16 till now, it's been rabbit business.
Okay.
So I'll say roughly 15 years of rabbit business.
Okay.
Yeah.
Now, to start a rabbit farm, what and what do I need? What are the most important things that one need in rabbit rearing?
Okay. The most important thing that you need to start a rabbit farm is the cage, which is the hatches.
You mean the structures behind us?
The structures behind us. The cage. And then where to keep it. That's the most important thing. Then you get the feeders, you get a good breeding stock from a good source, a good farmer, and then you are good to go.
Okay. Do we have varieties of rabbits that you have to start with?
Yes, we have different varieties.
Which ones do you have in your farm now?
Okay, we have about close to 11 breeds, different breeds. We have the chinchilla, the New Zealand, the Dutch, the Palomino, the Californian, and a lot of them.
Okay. Yeah. So a startup person who is going to start wearing the, which two would you suggest, the two breeds that you suggest I can start with?
Okay. Depending on the knowledge the person has, I can recommend the New Zealand or chinchilla.
Okay.
Because they grow very fast.
Okay.
And then they have a good, they build a lot of meat in a very short time, very quick. But most of the breeds we have, okay, I would say most of the breeds I have currently are crossbreeds. So any breed at all that you pick will grow very fast for you and put on the meat weight that you need at a particular time.
Okay. Starting off as a newcomer, do I need to buy a pregnant rabbit or I can buy the one that is not pregnant and then I would nurture it until I cross them to get pregnant?
Okay. The most important thing, okay, after getting the structure, or even before going to get the structure, every individual who wants to start rabbit farming needs to gather information about them. You need to have a knowledge on them before going into it. So that will inform your decision as to which one to go for.
Okay.
But then it's always advisable that you pick the ones that have not, that have not conceived or have not given birth before.
Okay.
Let them
virgin.
Let them get used to your environment, your way of feeding. and then you start crossing them from there. That's where you start your production.
Okay.
Then before they start conceiving, they have already adopted
the environment.
To your environment and your way of feeding and all of that.
Okay.
You get me? So they won't have any challenge at all with the change of environment. Mm. But then when you pick the one that is already pregnant, it will be a little difficult because some changes that you would implement might get it kind of frustrated.
Okay, it will affect it.
Yeah, it can affect it. Mm. So, because everybody have his or her own caging structure. Mm. And then if the comfort that they have here is not the same as where
they get where you're taking them.
Yeah, they are taking them. Then they will have a little bit of complications.
So what age old rabbit do you recommend I buy to start off?
From 5 months.
From 5 months, I can buy it.
Yes, you can
buy it. So how long will it take at my end before I cross the male and female?
Okay, from 5 months, you can even get them on heat as at the time you are buying them.
Okay.
So within a week, you can start crossing them from your end. The most important thing is to identify when they are on heat. Mm. That is when they are the females are ovulating. Mm. As for the males, they are always there to cross.
Mm.
So you identify when the female is on heat, that is when it's ovulating, then you cross it.
Okay. When I cross a rabbit, how long does it take for it to get pregnant?
Immediately you cross, they are pregnant.
Okay.
They get pregnant. That's if the male is successful.
Right.
It's kind of potent, and then the female is also potent.
Fertile. Okay.
Immediately they have intercourse.
They are pregnant.
She gets pregnant.
Okay.
And then it will take you between 30 to 32 days for her to litter, to give birth.
Okay. And how many babies will a first timer be able to produce?
Oh, it depends on the breed and how well the management is.
Okay.
But then the number ranges from 4 to, let's say, 15, 12, 10, thereabout. It also depends on the breed you have.
Okay.
So it's in between from 4 to, the highest can be 12, 13, 15, but then the lowest should be like 4 or 3.
All right.
Yeah.
Okay, now let's talk about the feed. You kept mentioning feed.
Yeah.
And right in front of us, we have three varieties of feed.
Yeah.
We have the regular grass, we have the moringa, and then the feed you have made yourself.
Yeah.
Now, how do this feed help the rabbits in growing?
In growing, okay. Most of the time, the feed that we give them, it helps them to build up a lot of meat.
Okay.
In a short time, it makes them grow faster.
Okay.
You get me? Because the feed is prepared especially for them.
Okay.
Okay. The grass also contains a lot of fiber.
Okay.
And it helps their digestive system to resist certain infections like diarrhea and other stuff.
Mm.
And then with the moringa, it's also medicinal.
Mm.
It helps. It boosts their immune system.
Okay.
And
so
helps
this is the
them,
moringa.
Yeah. Mm. This is the moringa. It helps them to fight certain infections that might kind of occur in their either new environment or from other animals around.
Okay. So do you blend them at a go, or there are times you give them the prepared feed, there are times you give them the moringa, and there are times you give them the grass? How do you go about the feeding?
It depends. Mm. Sometimes you can mix the moringa, you kind of remove the leaves.
The leaves, okay.
And mix it with the feed.
Okay.
That is if you are not going to get enough for all of them, depending on the number you have on your farm.
Mm.
So the grass, we give it to them separate.
Okay.
But the moringa, you can give it to them separate, you can mix it up with the feed.
Oh, okay.
But you always have to consider the, let's say, the nutritional value that you are preparing for them.
All right. How many times in a day do you feed the rabbits?
Okay, I feed them twice in a day, morning and evening.
Okay.
And then in the morning, we give them the feed.
Mm.
In the evening, we give them grass. Mm. Or we give them grass in the morning and then feed in the evening, depending on the schedule I have.
All right. In your presentation, you mentioned about infection.
Yeah.
Do rabbits also get affected with infections?
Yes, they get affected. They get a lot of infections.
What are those infections?
From other animals.
Okay.
Coccidiosis worries them. Diarrhea worries them.
Mm.
They have ear canker, ear mites.
Okay.
They have varieties of skin diseases as well.
Okay.
And some intestinal worms and all of that disturbs them.
So how do you go by treating those infections? And how do you even realize that my rabbit is suffering from this? How do you check?
Okay. First of all, when you keep the farm clean, you cut off infection by 70%.
Okay.
That's what I always tell my farmers. And then the second thing is you feed them well. When you feed them well, you also cut away infection by some 20%.
Mm.
So the 10%, the 10% is going to be like maybe other animals around or maybe some infection with the feed and all of that.
Mm.
So we have medications for them though.
Okay.
But then these are the three things. When you get it right, you hardly have your animals
getting infection. Okay.
Yeah.
Right. Now let's talk about the weather. Then we can go for our first break. What kind of weather temperature is mostly suitable for rabbits?
Okay. There is no specific weather that is suitable for them. But then they don't like too much heat and they don't like too much cold.
Mm.
You get me?
Mm.
So depending on where you want to keep them, you need to build the structure in such a way that it controls their environment for them. Because we have two systems. We have the indoor system and then the outdoor system. I am using the outdoor
system. Okay.
You get me? So I don't really have problem because I have made the cages in such a way that it controls the temperature in the cage. For them, when the weather is very hot, the cage is cool. It's kind of warm. And when the weather is very cold, because it's not too ventilated, their heat that they generate, it warms
it keeps
up
them warm.
The warm. It warms up the room for them. So no matter the weather condition, I do my production very well.
Okay.
I don't have any problem with the change of weather at all.
Okay. So viewers, if you're just tuning in, you're watching The Ghanaian Farmer. My name is Enyanam, and today's discussion is tailored towards rabbit farming here in Ghana. And we have a first degree holder in oil and gas processing, but he says this is what brings me the gold. This is what brings me the pounds, yes. And he's been doing it for quite some time. We're going for our first break. There's more after this. Thanks for staying. If you're just tuning in, you're watching The Ghanaian Farmer. You can share your views and send us your questions on our social media platform, The Ghanaian Farmer, on Facebook, LinkedIn, YouTube, The Ghanaian Farmer. If you missed it, Mondays, 1:30 p.m. prompt on Joy Prime, just go on YouTube. There are a lot of episodes there. Today, our focus is on rabbit farming. And I have Andy, the CEO of The Unique Farms, right here with me. So, Andy, I want to know the difference between the rabbit you have here and that of which is in the bush. So, tell me, is there any difference between the two?
Okay, there is no much difference. The only difference I would say is that these ones have been domesticated.
Okay.
So, they are used to like people around them, and even if you leave them around, they won't go far or destroy any of your stuff, but then you have to still control them. But then the bush ones don't grow like the way these ones are, because these ones are crossbreeds which were imported.
Okay.
You get me? So the bush ones are more or less of the local wild ones, which is a bit difficult
to even control
domestically. But then these ones have been grown domestically, so they are used to.
Have you ever attempted to cross the bush one and this one before?
I've not attempted
but is
to
it possible?
Do it. It's possible, but I have not attempted to do it because the way these ones grow compared to the way the bush ones, it's not something I would want to see. The outcome will not help me because now everyone is going for the big sizes that grow very fast and all of that. So these ones are more or less like 4 months.
All right.
4-3 months. But then
you
can take
big.
You can take the big, the bush one, which is 1 year, and will still be smaller than this
one. That's true. Now let's show me, open it up and show me how I'm able to identify which is male and which is female. And the breeds you mentioned, which one do we have here?
Okay, this is the Dutch breed.
Okay.
These are the Dutch breeds.
Okay.
And then we have the New Zealand in here.
Okay.
But then
today we are in trouble. Okay. Let me help you.
All right. So this is the female.
Okay.
And then this is how to check their organ.
Okay.
This is the female organ. This is the anus.
Okay.
You get me?
I
so
see.
When you pick them up, you just press it back and then you see
that's fine.
That's the female.
Okay.
And then with the males, when they are matured, you get they have testicles.
Hey!
You can see.
Rabbit testicle, I'm para.
Okay, this one is not that grown yet.
Okay.
But if you want to
check if it's a female or a male.
Yes, you just have to check.
Check,
there.
All right.
So you can see the difference.
Mm. Yeah. Oh, my love. Where are you going?
You can see the difference. Mm. You know, that one is more or less like open.
All right.
And this one is straight. Close. Okay. It's more or less like...
All right, so this is a male and a female. Yeah. Now, I see some difference in the eye color. This has a dark colored eye and the white one here. Yes. Okay, let me, for the purpose of our viewers...
Yeah.
Now, give me that one so that they will not run away. Don't run away. This white one has a red eye.
Yes.
Why? Eesh. Why is it like that? Hey,
is the breed.
Give me the cover. Is the breed, eh?
Yes.
Okay.
Is the breed.
Okay.
They come with different eye colors. Mm. Some have brown, blue, black, and all of that.
Okay.
So that most of the time, the New Zealand white,
okay,
they come with the orange eye, sort of, or the red eye, okay, sort of. And then we have the Californian as well. Mm. They also have the same eye color, white body, and then they have a black spot on the nose, the ear, and their foot.
Right.
Those are the Californian white, and this is New Zealand.
Okay. Now, Andy, tell me, how much is involved in rabbit rearing, especially as a startup?
Okay, now it's becoming a little bit expensive if you want to do the right thing.
Yes.
So let's say for a beginner, you need about 1,000 cedis to start.
For the structure?
For the structure, the rabbit, the feed. Yes.
1,000.
And then the feeders, yes, 1,000 cedis.
But it's rabbit's business, a capital intensive business, and is it also profitable?
I would say, for instance, that it will be capital intensive if you want to do large scale.
Okay.
If you want to do it big, it will be capital intensive.
Okay.
But then if you want to start small, you don't need a huge capital. You can start in a small corner and then grow as they
will
produce.
How about the profitability? How much do you sell this one? Assume I want to buy.
Yes.
I want this one. How much
depending on the quality of the breed, it ranges from 50 cedis to 100 cedis.
Okay.
For the breeding stock, let's say for me, it ranges from 50 to 80. That's for breeding stock. And then 80 to 100 for meat.
Okay.
Yeah.
How is the market demand for rabbit meat?
The demand, I would say, is going up every day or each and every time. Mm. Because for me, I would say I don't really sell during season like Christmas or Easter or something. I sell
the whole year round.
Yes, all year round, like every day. Mm. Because people demand different breeding, meat and all of that. Mm. So I sell all year round.
Who are mainly your customers? Is it restaurant, hotel, individuals?
Restaurant, hotels, individuals, other farmers.
Right.
Yes.
Okay, now let me take you back a bit. When a rabbit gives birth, the baby rabbit, do they eat the same meal that their parents eat?
Yes, when they give birth, for the first 3 weeks, for the first 2 weeks, they are very small. Mm-hmm. They don't eat, they only breastfeed.
Okay.
And then from, let's say, the third week, they start learning how to eat anything that you give to their mother, because they get out of the litter box.
Right.
And they start moving around, chasing their mother.
Okay.
So from 4 weeks, you can decide to separate them from their mother. That's the weaning. Or you can leave them for 6 weeks, depending on the number she gave littered, so that they can all have enough breast milk before weaning them. But when they are few, you can wean them faster. But when they are more, you have to leave them for 6 weeks before you wean them, before you take them from their mother.
Apart from meat and also keeping it as a pet, what other importance or benefits does one derive from rabbit farming? Like, for instance, the urine, the feces, the skin, what other important?
There are a lot of benefits. Mm. Aside the nutritional value of the meat, and the people sell the feces. For me, I don't sell it, but other people come for it and use it for their gardens and their vegetable farms.
Okay.
And the skin is also very useful in making coats and bags and like in the form of leather.
Okay.
People use the leg, the foot for key holders and all of that. And then the urine, other people use it for insecticide and disinfectants and all of that.
Yes, rabbit
a lot of
urine.
People. Yes, a lot of people are using it for fertilizer, insecticide and disinfectants nowadays. And I think everything about the rabbits is...
It's very, no waste.
Yeah, it's no waste.
I see.
It's no waste. But you have to tap into the market.
Okay.
Get the right people who need it. Mm. And then you get it for them.
Mm. Yeah. I see. So viewers, you're still watching The Ghanaian Farmer. Seated next to me is Andy Blousey. Like I said, the third name is in one corner. When I write the full name on the screen, you get to know. He's the founder, the CEO of The Unique Farms. Coming up in 60 seconds on Agric. When we come back, we'll wrap up the interview. Stay tuned. Gone by was 60 seconds on Agric. This program is proudly brought to you by Lizzy Tomato Mix. My name is Enyonam Manye. When you see me in town, call me Ghana's finest farmer. Yes. And I still have Blousey with me. So we are wrapping up the interview. But what opportunities do you see in rabbit farming? And would you, is there anything you would want government to do to help this sector, the rabbit sector, expand, scale up? And of course, attract more people, especially those who are crying for job opportunities. Is there anything you want to touch on?
Yes, there is great potential in rabbit farming, if I should put it that way. And for me, I've never regretted being a rabbit farmer because it has really pushed me very far. Mm. I have seen a couple of programs springing up now. Mm. Zinator Rollins, she has started something with the youth, training them in rabbit farming and mushroom. Mm. And I believe they have seen the potential in it. That's why they've started such things. Mm. But then some way, somehow, I also look at it from the other point where the people, the farmers who are already in the system doing it well, why don't they come together and push them? Mm. You get me? Because if we are able to grow bigger, we can reach out to more people. We can help more people to push the farming in a different level. Because it right now demands a lot of capital. Mm-hmm. For me, I'm solely depending on it.
Okay.
So it's more or less like when the money comes, I divide it into three parts, and then one goes to the farming. So the progress is slow. Mm. But if we should get support, we will do far better.
Okay.
Far. Because the demand, we are not able to supply the demand that is coming. Mm. And if I always say that sometimes if we take certain things like this for granted, by the time we will know, the Chinese will start producing. Because sometimes when you go outside, the meat is cheap.
Okay.
But over here, it's quite expensive because of
the limited number of people who are rearing
it, the cost of feeding, and some few challenges that are attached to it. Mm. So it makes it expensive. But when we scale up, when we are able to grow bigger, we will definitely cut down the price, and each and everyone, every household can afford rabbit meat.
Okay. All right. So are you open for training?
Yes, we do trainings. Mm. We sell the cages, we sell the rabbits, we sell grilled meat and everything about rabbits.
Okay.
Yes.
Now, this is quite a big farm. This is not too small. About the maintenance, how do you handle it? Do you do it all alone? How do you ensure that the cages are always clean and everything that needs to be there is always available? Do you do this all alone?
I don't do it alone. I do it together with my worker and then my wife.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay.
So we are three people.
All right.
Managing the farm.
Okay. How long does it take a trainee to get used to and understand the process and then start something on their own?
Okay. It depends on what you want to train on. But then with the full training, we do it for 2 weeks. Mm. That's 14 days. Mm. And then if you want to specifically train for how to make the feeders, it's some 2 days. Yeah. If you want to train on medication, how to medicate them, how to prepare their feed and all of that, it's also 2 days
so each. Approximately we are looking at how many weeks?
Yes, 2 weeks for the full training. Yes, and then with the training, we give out certificates as well. Okay. And then we have a starter pack. Mm. When you come for the training, it's not like you train and then you go and buy everything again. When you train, whatever you train for, we give you a package
to start off with. Yes. Okay. And when they want the feed today, you can also supply the feed
as well.
Okay. Would you say you've regrets embarking on this journey, putting aside your degree and embarking on this journey? Have you any regret?
I have never regretted, though sometimes the challenges makes you feel like quitting. Mm. But the thing is, even whatever I have gotten to, it's the rabbit that pushed me there. Mm. It's rabbit with the rabbit that I was able to fund my education to a certain level and to where I am right now. It's only that sometimes when we go, when I represent Ghana in other parts of the world, I feel like not coming back, because it's like what we are doing back there and what we go to see is far different.
Mm.
And sometimes you just want to stay there and enjoy the luxury there and the farm technology and everything they have there, rather than coming back to your old method of doing whatever.
So the advanced way of rearing rabbits.
There are so many advanced ways of rearing rabbit, but it's just a little bit expensive.
Okay.
But then the thing is, like I said, if we get the support from the government, if the government is able to encourage we the youth, trust me, rabbit farming is something that can change your life around.
I see.
Because I've never regretted it, doing it, because it has pushed me this far. I have a family, and we are all depending on it.
Okay.
So if it's a bad thing, if it's a bad thing, I would have quit long ago.
Of course, your wife will even go away.
I would have quit a long time ago. So it's a very good venture that I encourage the youth to go into it. A lot of the old people are now going into it because they are looking at retiring and then coming to do something that is not too tedious. And rabbit farming is not that tedious.
All right.
So
it's one of the best you want to consider.
Yes, you want to consider. But then I encourage the youth to get into it.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Blausi, Andy, he's encouraging the youth to venture into rabbit farming. It's not so much tedious at all. This is where we wrap up our interview on rabbit farming. A very insightful one for that matter. You have no excuse to say, I don't have money, because there is a lot of ways you can make money. And one of them is what you've just watched on the Ghanaian Farmer. My name is Sanyanam, and many thanks to Andy, the CEO of the Unique Farms, for having us. And many thanks. Shout out to my Shatawale cameraman, SM cameraman. Shout out to you, and shout out to Brata, who I have captured him today to bring me all over. So, I mean, all the way to this place. And shout out to shout out to Stanley Charles, the marketing manager of Crocodile Market. Shout out to you. And hey, Christmas is around the corner, so you want to stay with us. There's a lot more we'll bring in your way. If you are out there and you want to advertise or sponsor this program, just call the number displayed on your screen. Next week, I'll see you again. Bye.